Mini chapter 106. Amber heading east on a mission to murder. As the club night nears its climactic moment, it coasts at leisure up the last few meters to that summit, resting easy on the climb that's lifted it there. The music ascends to a long crest of joy and magic, calling down the spirits to the server farm. Then it falls, echoing away, down and back into the past. The underground warehouse is plunged into darkness. The last little red and green lights go dim on the servers, and just at the instant when the dull flatness of the house lights comes on, Herb pulls the beasts deftly out of the West Side environment of Bangdead's game, propelling them back up into real life. As they streak upwards, the beasts catch a final glimpse of the server stacks, standing dark and inert down the length of every aisle. Then, barreling up into the house on Electra Drive, they proceed to emerge, one by one, through Jaymi's computer monitor and clamber out into meat space. On screens across the world, the six news feeds, constituting the bulk of Ain't They Freaky, all grind to a halt within the same minute. Millions of users on every continent tap hyperlinks and refresh pages with mounting impatience but no success, while a deluge of error messages swells around the world, like a giant tide of deadness laid on deadness. The beasts stand scattered around their maker's study, all on a delirious high, aglow with an aura of triumph and excitement, and panting from their exertions. Jaymi darts from one to the next, embracing them in turn, kissing each on the forehead. "Thank you," he tells them all. "I love you." Then he turns to his ex-colleagues and gives them both a hug, and thank you too, so much. Herb's and Ashley's mobile devices both start flashing and vibrating. A sense of come down to reality returns as the two of them identify the incoming numbers and speak almost in tandem with an apprehensive weariness. "That's Bangdead." "Ah," says Jaymi, "I suppose it would be. I imagine they're wondering why their game just crashed. I think you'd both better scarper. The less you're associated with this house from now on, the better, for all our sakes." "True. We're out of here," says Herb, gathering his things at speed. "Okay, we'll talk on the phone," says Ashley, gathering hers. "Let yourselves out downstairs. I'll open the front gates from here." 5 minutes later, the CCTV shows the property's gates closing after their two cars have exited and turned onto the slope of Electra Drive. He turns to his beasts. "So, welcome back to real life. Amber, could you remain here? I need one more thing from you. The rest of you, go home, chill out, and rest if you please. That was magic this evening." When the study door has closed behind Evelyn, Shigim, Kim, and the Platinum Raven, Jaymi turns to face the remaining beast, who is looking at his creator with that unnerving perceptiveness of his. "Amber, I have one more mission for you," says Jaymi. "Kelly broke through Herb's defences while you were down there and cut you all, as you won't need reminding. It's late at night now, so she may not have wanted to call Dud at his home to tell him she broke through. She may not yet have let him know, but as soon as she does, we are all in massive trouble. I'd therefore like you to drive over to Factory Place, gain access to Kelly, and terminate her with the very minimum of pain, please. Do you understand?" Amber considers this, then nods. "Yes." "Thank you," says Jaymi. "I'll be watching." Amber gives a calm salute, then leaves the study. Once the CCTV app has shown the front gates closing after Amber's departing car, Jaymi glances around the room where he now sits alone at his desk chair, closes his eyes, and contemplates his beast's eastward progress down the freeway. It'll be a rendezvous from which Kelly is unlikely to come out well. And for a moment, the ghost of that old question hovers. Has he been despotic in acting as he has towards Bangdead Games and the Dreary Ones? No, he has not, because in emanating Ain't They Freaky, Bangdead's despotism has been much worse. That game kills, in greater number, albeit indirectly, and it will always kill. If left alone, it would never change. Such is its nature, and such is the power it derives from its obscene spread. He directs his attention to pick up where Amber's car has got to and finds it approaching the northern fringes of downtown. As the time ticks away in deadly silence on his screen, he returns to a contemplation of what he's doing here. Should he allow his own creation, this dangerous but controllable beast, to go ahead to that loft and hunt Kelly down? For unless Jaymi takes proactive steps to intervene, Amber will now kill her. He's a beast whose very code was designed to comply with Jamie's specific instructions to target Dard and the other dreary ones. That's just one of the things Amber is equipped to do if commanded to, like a weapon. But how can Jaymi ignore the fact that Kelly is another human being, with all that's implied by this status? She's another vortex of consciousness, like Jaymi himself. He shouldn't let her be killed. He knows it would be wrong, in some ways. Not to mention, Jaymi himself may be discovered to have caused her death. If so, he may be punished hard for it, very likely being found guilty of manslaughter at least. Allowing Amber to kill Kelly may end up landing Jaymi in prison, turning him into some kind of outlaw from society. This would change his life, and not for the better. It would also shut him rudely away from those grand missions of his to leave the world just a teeny tad lovelier for all its denizens than it used to be. But as he contemplates again what Ain't They Freaky does to the world, the destructive and uglifying effects it has and will have on millions globally, and how those people will be influenced to treat one another as a direct result of Ain't They Freaky, he remembers another truth, an equal truth, strong enough to face off countervailing truths such as the aforementioned and smack those down. That this is a genuine war, in effect. Owing to her work, Kelly is a general in this war. As such, she damages and kills, is clearly happy to do so, and appears most unlikely ever to change in these respects. She's altogether beastlier than Amber is. So yes, when she is contemplated through clear eyes, it's plain she does deserve to die. Jamie's actions have been nothing but legitimate war. He's glad he has thought this through. The upshot at this moment, he will take no action. He will not deflect Amber from his mission. He will leave Amber free to continue it. He directs his attention to Amber's car again and finds it on the fringes of Skid Row, on East 4th Street between Alameda and Central, nearing Factory Place. The beast has almost reached her. He rests his head in his hands as a new question arises. Why did he not instruct Amber to visit the Blue Jay Way House instead of the Factory Place loft? Sure, Kelly did need to be prevented from apprising Dard of her breaking through into the club night. Still, Jaymi can't help feeling he was somehow stalling here in sending Amber towards Dard's employee rather than towards the ultimate quarry, which is surely Dard himself. And a further brand new question pops up. Is Jaymi stalling, furthermore, in targeting her through the agency of a beast? He retreats away from this reflection and bends his attention back eastwards in earnest.